Hello, good morning, everybody. If you want to find a place to sit, I'm guessing there's plenty of room for you today. I think a lot of people were unwilling to brave the icy streets to get here. On my way here, we saw about two cars, and I was afraid when I arrived there wouldn't be anybody. But I'm glad you all made it safely. No fender benders in the parking lot, right? I don't see any raised hands, so I guess we're good. Drive safely home as well. Okay, well, you know the drill. We've got yellow communication cards in the back of the pew in front of you. If you are a visitor today, you won't know the drill. So if you're a visitor, would you please grab one of those cards and fill it out and just leave it on the pew next to you? We would love to know that you were here. You can also use those cards if you have prayer requests or something that you would like to communicate to the church staff. So please grab them and use them for that. Now, if you are a first-time visitor, if you have never been to our church before, we have a special gift for you. So we would love for you to duck out after the service to the Welcome Center, which is in the lobby right out through these doors, and someone will greet you there. We have a gift that we'd like to give you. Now, because of the holidays, because of Christmas and New Year's, Sunday school has been suspended for today and for next Sunday. So keep that in mind. Your visit to church will be shorter today because after the service is over, you only have to pick up your free gift if you're a visitor, and then we're gonna let you go. So just so you know that for the comfort and safety of everyone, the church has installed hospital-grade air filters in their HVAC system. So you can all breathe a little easier now. If you have ordered a Warm Lake Camp calendar as part of the Warm Lake fundraiser, those were $15 a piece. And if you ordered one and haven't picked it up yet, there's a table set up out in the lobby and they will get that into your hands. However, if you did not pre-order, they had extras printed and they are available for $15, although we don't want you to feel limited by that. If you wanted to throw in something extra, I'm sure they would be delighted to accept that. So please, if you need any calendars, if you'd like to give them away as gifts, if you just want to support Warm Lake Camp, please step over to the table out in the lobby and pick up some calendars. Now, new directory is coming. If you are new to First Baptist Church in the last year, we would love to include you in the directory. Apparently, everybody else is caught up, but if you're new, we would like to add you, and we don't want anybody to be left out. So, if that is the case, would you please grab that yellow communication card, connection card. I keep calling it by the wrong name. If you would grab that and make a note on that so that someone can contact you, we would like to get you added to our directory. Now, I don't know about you, but I love when I arrive at church on Sunday morning and there's somebody at the door to greet me as I come in. That's how I know I'm late, if somebody is already at the door. But if somebody greets you when you come in, that's because somebody has taken the time to be here a little bit early and put a smile on their face and say a little prayer and welcome you all in when you come to the door. And if you would like to be a part of that ministry for 2021, we would love to hear from you. The yellow connection card can be used for that as well. Those are versatile little things. Or you can contact Pastor John Tesort directly. He's kind of in charge of that. The commitment is brief. It's only a few Sundays a year. So if you'd like to have the opportunity to smile and shake a hand or rub an elbow and greet some people as they come in and just be a part of that ministry, we could certainly use your help. So I'd urge you to pray about that. Now, the church office is going to be closed tomorrow and also on Thursday this week. That would be New Year's Eve. So keep that in mind if you need to contact the church for anything. There's an offering box, just a reminder, out in the foyer if you would like to leave your gifts there. And there's a lot more information in the bulletin because I can't cover it all. So be sure and pick that up and read it.
Good morning, church. Well, as we prepare our hearts to worship, I want to give you one more announcement, and that is that at the end of the service, after we're done singing, we're going to show a video update from one of our missionaries. And it's going to be something that is a little different because we have to show it while we're not recording, so those who are watching at home are not going to be able to see it. But as you may know, certain missionaries are ministering in countries where they don't want their information posted online because of its sensitive nature, and so you get the privilege of being able to hear about that, but those who are watching online are not going to be able to see that, and perhaps they can find that out at another time. Well, would you stand with me, please, as we say the verse of the month? But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. Isaiah 53:5. You may be seated. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we want to come before you this morning, knowing that you are Lord of all, that you are the one who is our worship leader. You are the one who leads us by your Holy Spirit to follow you, to trust you, to have faith in you, and to worship you. And I pray, Lord, that our worship today would not be in vain, that we would not worship out of hollowness, that we would not worship out of faithlessness, that we would not go through the motions today. But I pray, Lord, that we have come with hearts full. We have come with sincerity. We have come with genuine, authentic desire to follow you. And I pray, dear Lord, that you would stir in us the kind of worship that Jesus talked about by worshiping in spirit and in truth. And Lord, I pray that you would remove any wayward way in our hearts so that we can worship you in purity. And I pray, Lord, that as we sing and we listen and we think, Lord, that all these things would be to your glory, and that we would dedicate this time to you and to you alone. And so we pray these things, Lord God, that we would not leave unchanged, but Lord, that we would come expectantly, ready for your truth to transform us into Christ's image. And all God's people said, amen.
Let's all stand as we continue to worship. We're going to begin with another scripture. It's Matthew 1:18-23, to remind us, even though our Christmas celebrations may be ebbed back a little bit right now, we want to continue to remember our Lord and Savior, the reason for this season that we celebrate. So let's begin by reading Matthew 1:18-23. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man, unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us.
Infant holy, infant lowly, for his bed a cattle stall, oxen lowing, little knowing, Christ the baby is Lord of all. Swifter ringing, angels singing, Noel's ringing, tidings bringing, Christ the baby is Lord of all. Christ the baby is Lord of all. Flocks are sleeping, shepherds keeping, keeping vigil till the morning new. Saw the glory, heard the story, tidings of a gospel true. Thus rejoicing, free from sorrow, praises voicing, greet the morrow. Christ the babe was born for you. Christ the babe was born for you. While by the sheep we watched at night, glad tidings brought an angel bright. How great our joy, great our joy. Joy, 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 joy. Praise ye the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord on heaven on high. There shall be born, so he did say, in Bethlehem a child today. How great our joy, our joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. There shall the child in a stall, this child who shall redeem us all. How great our joy, great our joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. This gift of God we'll cherish well, that ever joy our heart shall fill. Great our joy, great our joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. streams flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Well, church, I want to give you a little bit of just a picture of what's coming up in the month of January. We're taking a break from our series in Genesis. And as leaders, we have actually come up with a new vision and mission statement for the church. And so January is going to be a month where we're going to look at, as a church, what we stand for and what we're about. And I don't think it could be more timely because a lot has changed in this year. We've gone through a lot, and as a church, things have happened and things have just changed our whole environment of where we live. And it's time to get recentered on why we exist as a church. And so I want to really encourage you, don't miss the sermons in January, because it's talking about specifically why we exist as a church and what we're here to do. But in the meantime, this morning, we're going to continue our worship with a special speaker. And I want to go ahead and just tell you a little bit about him. His name is Jason Hudson, and the Hudson family has been coming to our church for a little over a year now. And one of the neat things about my connection with him and Nate and Katie's and Bethany's connection with the Hudsons is that Jason went to Moody with us. So apparently this is now the new gathering place of the people who graduated from Moody Bible Institute in the 1990s. So just been so neat to get to know them. He's been a pastor in Seattle as well as North Carolina, and has just been a blessing to our church here. And he has a message for the Lord from us. So would you give him a First Baptist welcome?
Well, it surely is an honor to be up here this morning. I just want to say thank you to Brett and Nate and their families and to everybody here at First Baptist Caldwell. You've been so welcoming. When we came in the first time and people just began to greet us, we just felt like this was a place where we belonged. And so it's been a joy to be here. And it's a special day, not only because it's such an honor to be able to preach the Word of God and be entrusted with it. I know what it is to be a pastor and to say, here, take the pulpit. It really is an honor to have that trust put within you to preach the gospel. Today is also a special day for a couple other reasons. First of all, my mom and dad are here from Seattle. They joined us for Christmas, and it's my mom's birthday today. So happy birthday, Mom, and just an honor to be their son. Additionally, today is Katie's and mine 17th anniversary. So it's just a day of celebration. And Katie and I, it was actually a miracle we got married. I'm a Seahawks fan, and she's a Packers fan. So God works in miraculous ways, and it's truly an honor to be married to you as well, Katie. So she's the cute one that's blushing over here, if you don't know who she is. I don't know about you, Brett, but I always found that Christmas sermons were the hardest. And the reason that they're hard isn't because they're not special. They're incredible. It's amazing what occurred at Christmas time. But the difficult part with Christmas sermons are that everybody's heard it before. Everybody who comes to church says, yeah, I've heard that. Or there's another thing that creeps up, and that is, I love Christmas so much. Just give me the nostalgic feeling that I'm looking for. And then I'll go home and we'll have our Christmas meal and it'll just give me the feeling of Christmas. So I always found them a little bit difficult with Christmas time. And yet there's something miraculous in the Christmas story that needs to be addressed. And I love that we began with these Christmas carols and that we address the fact that Jesus Christ, God, became man. There's something critical that comes at Christmas time and extends throughout the whole year that we need to address, and that is Jesus is relevant all the time. Amen? I remember sitting at a Bob Evans, a diner in the Midwest, but it was also North Carolina. And as we were at the diner eating, they had the little advertisements around the table to try to get you to buy other things on top of your meal. And there was one that looked amazing. There was these pies there. And it was Christmas time, and it had these pictures of pies, and it said, "The reason for the season." That's blasphemy. As delicious as pies are, they are not the reason of the season, but there's something else more important, is that Jesus is not just the reason for this season. He's the reason for every season. He's the reason for all of history and all of eternity. It all is about Jesus. And so as we come off of Christmas and we head towards the rest of the year, it must be imperative that we go back and we look at Jesus and just bathe in the fact that how grand he is, and then his extension of love towards us, not only in Christmas, but also throughout his death and his resurrection and his ascension as king, and then his presentation to us of this great message of the gospel. It's incredible. So this morning we're going to go back and we're going to look at Jesus because he is it. And I mentioned my wife was a Packers fan. There was a great coach for the Packers named Vince Lombardi. In fact, the trophy that they give after the Super Bowl is called the Lombardi Trophy. He was an incredible coach. One of the great things about him coaching is that he always focused on the fundamentals. That's often true with the great coaches. They always bring the team back to the fundamentals. There was a time when the Green Bay Packers went through a tough stretch. They were a great team, but they kept losing and losing. And so he came to practice one day, and he gathered the guys around. And instead of installing new plays and this and that, he took a football and he said to the guys, "Guys, this is a football." He was bringing them back to the essence of what they were about. It's about a football. And we come to this, the reason for this season, the reason for everything is Jesus. And so we want to springboard off of Christmas and we want to continue on looking at Jesus. So this morning we're going to go to the book of Luke, and we're going to jump into chapter 17. Now, this is far beyond Christmas time, far into Jesus' life. But such an amazing story as it continues to address just why Jesus came and why he was translated into flesh, why he became the incarnate Son of God. So in Luke chapter 17, we find Jesus, and he's been going throughout his ministry. He's been healing people. He's been casting out demons. He's been teaching his disciples. He's been preaching on mountainsides. He's been traveling from Galilee to Jerusalem and everywhere in between. He's been doing his ministry. He's been helping people. And so we get to chapter 17. We're going to start in verse 11. I'm going to invite you to open your Bible. I'm not going to have the passage on the screen. If you do have your Bible, please join us there or grab your pew Bible. But we're in Luke chapter 17. We're going to start in verse 11. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. So this is Jesus. He's traveling. He was up in the north. So one of the things I love about the way God made you, most of us, hopefully you got one, is you have a map right on your body. It's the hand map. Everybody got that? So if you look at your hand map, this is Israel. The bottom part is Judea. That's where Jerusalem was. That's where the temple was. That's where Bethlehem would have been down in Judea. In the middle, you have Samaria. That was a place where Jews did not like to go because there was people called Samaritans there. They were half Jewish, half breeds, half dirty, is what the Jews thought. So there was Samaria in the middle, and in the top was Galilee, which is where Jesus grew up in the town of Nazareth. So this tells us that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem in the south. He was headed there from Galilee, and he was going right in between that middle point of Galilee and Samaria. But it says he was on his way to Jerusalem, and that is important. Because back in chapter 9, verse 51, it says that Jesus set his face towards Jerusalem. That means he was determined to go there. He was resolute and focused. I must get to Jerusalem. I wasn't meant just to stay in Galilee in my hometown. I shouldn't just go around the country. I must get to Jerusalem. And he's going to Jerusalem because this would be the Passover feast. This would probably be his, what would be his 33rd and final Passover feast. And we know that as he goes there, he becomes not only part of the feast, he is the feast. He is the Passover lamb. And so Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem for this very important mission that he's been given from the Father to go and to die. Verse 12, this then tells us, "And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance." So Jesus is coming upon this village. There's 10 lepers that are outside of this village, and they're standing at a distance. So what we need to do here is we kind of need to get a sense of these lepers. We talk about a leper and leprosy. We immediately begin to think of what is commonly known as leprosy nowadays. It's a disease caused by bacteria that begins to affect the nerves. You lose feeling in your body, and as a result, you can't sense pain. If you burn yourself, you don't know it. Your skin just begins to rot. People's noses would begin to wear away. Toes and things would fall off. I mean, it was bad. Leprosy was bad. But there's more than that. So what we want to do is we want to go back to the book of Leviticus and see what it tells us about lepers. So if you would join me, let's go to Leviticus chapter 13. So when Jesus came, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years before that, God had set up a covenant with his people Israel, a relationship. And in that relationship, he extended to them a law. And in that law, there were people who helped maintain that law and do its ceremonial rites. Those were the priests, the Levites. And so they were given a book called Leviticus that was an instruction manual for them to do their job. This is the way that you are to do offerings. This is the way that you are to do feasts. And this is the way that you are to handle lepers. Because priests weren't only there for religious purposes, and they weren't just there for social purposes. In this context, they were also there for medical purposes. They had a pretty full-time job there. And so in Leviticus chapter 3, it's instruction to the priest as to how to handle lepers. So let's look at verse 1. "The Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, 'When a person has on the skin of his body a swelling or an eruption or a spot, and it turns into a case of leprous disease on the skin of his body, then he shall be brought to Aaron the priest, or to one of his sons, the priests, and the priest shall examine the diseased area on the skin of his body, and if the hair in the diseased area has turned white, and the disease appears to be deeper than the skin of his body, it is a case of leprous disease. When the priest has examined him, he shall pronounce him unclean. But if the spot is white in the skin of his body and appears no deeper than the skin and the hair in it has not turned white, the priest shall shut up the diseased person for 7 days. And the priest shall examine him on the 7th day. And if in his eyes the disease is checked and the disease has not spread in the skin, then the priest shall shut him up for another 7 days. And the priest shall examine him again on the 7th day, and if the diseased area has faded and the disease has not spread in the skin, then the priest shall announce him clean. It is only an eruption, and he shall wash his clothes and be clean. But if the eruption spreads in the skin, after he has shown himself to the priest for his cleansing, he shall appear again before the priest, and the priest shall look, and if the eruption has spread in the skin, then the priest shall announce him unclean. It is a leprous disease." So this is just the beginning of the priest examining the leprous person. The priest wasn't given a way to heal the leprous person. He was the one who would examine the leprous person and make this judgment call. You are either clean or you are unclean. And that had significant ramifications to the person who was being pronounced clean or unclean. For one, we're looking at very physical things. If you're unclean, you're still contagious. There's something going on in you that needs to be separated out. Two, if you are unclean, you are not allowed to approach the people nor the presence of God that was right in the center where the temple was. In the center of the temple was the most holy place. That's where God's glory would come over the Ark of the Covenant. The priest would go in on the Day of Atonement, 1 day a year. And if you were unclean, you can't be anywhere near that. And so being unclean was a removal, a separation from God. And there's more to all that that goes into being leprous. If you read on and on, there's stuff about white hair and more eruptions. I don't know about you, but I kind of start getting grossed out when I read Leviticus 13 with all these eruptions and things going on. But in fact, most of the description that is here about leprosy has little to do with the leprosy that we know about. It's actually more things like eczema, rashes, even acne. How many of you this morning feel a little bit like a leper? You had that little itch, and now you're wondering, am I clean or am I unclean? Should I go to Pastor Brett and have him examine me and be put out this morning? He's saying, no, that's not part of my job description. We're not doing lepers here this morning. And so there were serious ramifications. In fact, let's turn and skip forward to verse 45. Sorry, I hit the wrong chapter here. In my Bible, I was like, that's the wrong verse. Okay, here we go, 45. The leprous person who has the disease shall wear torn clothes, and let the hair of his head hang loose, and he shall cover his upper lip and cry out, unclean! Unclean! He shall remain unclean as long as he has the disease. He is unclean. He shall live alone. His dwelling shall be outside the camp. So this leprous person was to put on some signage. Torn clothes, the clothes that would have been representing almost death clothes. This guy is basically walking dead. Not only that, it said that the hair of the head was to be disheveled. You were supposed to be just unkept. You're supposed to cover the upper lip or mustache, it says in the footnotes. And you're to cry out, unclean! Unclean! And you're to be alone, and you're to be outside. I'm not sure if we as a society right now can identify too well with laws imposing people to be separated for 14 days, to wear a mask, and to be declared unclean and self-report, quarantined and feeling alone. I don't think we get that nowadays, do we? And yet that was the charge. You must be separated. You are unclean. You must declare it and wear it. And understand the separation that you are from the people. And so as Jesus comes into this village, we'll go back to Luke chapter 17. As Jesus comes into this village, he is met by these 10 lepers who at this point should have been wearing the ripped clothes, should have had their hair disheveled, were outside and they're from a distance and they should have been yelling, unclean, unclean. They knew what it was to be isolated. And yet as we go back to the story, they were supposed to be yelling unclean, and we find in verse 13 of Luke chapter 17, it says, and they lifted up their voices saying, Jesus! Master! Have mercy on us! Hey, wait a second. They're not saying what they're supposed to. But now they're crying out what they should. Jesus, the very name which we read earlier that was commanded to give this baby boy. Jesus means the eternal one who saves. They're crying out, eternal one who saves. And then they declare him master. This word for master is only used in the book of Luke. Whenever it is used in the book of Luke, it is often associated with moments of authority that Jesus takes. When healing people, casting out demons, having authority over nature. Because one who has authority has the opportunity to command. Master, the eternal one who says, command. Make this possible. We understand that you have the ability to work in our situation. Master, have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. Mercy, at its essence, means to have compassion. And that compassion extends to people who cannot help themselves. Mercy goes to people and removes affliction. In fact, you know what the word leprosy means, where it comes from in the Greek? It means one who's afflicted, one who is stricken. Figuratively, one who is stricken with leprosy. Mercy is the opposite. Let me remove your affliction. Let me help the one who is wretched. So they're crying out when, in the midst of this social moment, they should be saying, unclean, unclean. Instead, they are yelling, Jesus, Master, we have no way of helping ourselves. We are out here and we need you. We need your mercy. We need your compassion. We need your help to take away our affliction, to take it away from the wretched. At this moment, it's important. We recognize these lepers crying out, unclean, unclean. That we too, in some way, are probably this morning even identifying with the lepers, whether it's the masking or just the various ways that we too feel separated. For one, physically, sometimes we feel separated, whether with God or with others. In fact, just this morning, I put on my belt and I had fear that I would be rejected and outside in this place. Why? Because a couple days ago, I was putting on my brown belt and you know what happened? The buckle completely exploded. I should be making resolutions, I know. It totally explodes, but my brown belt was gone. So this morning I put on a black belt, and I looked down, I had a black belt and brown shoes. And you know what my first thought was? There are people at First Baptist Caldwell that are going to say, he's got a brown pair of shoes and a black belt. Was that because you've ever judged me? No, it's because I, in myself physically, was suddenly saying, there's something that's going to separate me from people. It's ridiculous in a Christian place, right? But there's a history there, not with this church. I was born in Nampa. We moved to Seattle. And in the third grade, I went to school, and I'm from Idaho, so I was wearing overalls. I went to school, and all recess, this boy ran around, followed me, yelling, Farmer boy, farmer boy. It was a Christian school. Physically, I felt separated because of what I wore. And so even this morning, as I put on a black belt and brown shoes, I thought, I'm going to the Christians. I might be separated. You know, that's not because of you. That's because of me. Maybe you're identifying with something physical like that that makes you feel like you're leprous in such a way. Maybe it's something that you cannot even control. I could have not worn a belt. Maybe that was more weird. But maybe you have something about yourself you can't control. You didn't control who your parents were or how you were made up. You didn't control where you were born. There's physical things about you that you just couldn't control. Socially, this also happens where we feel separated from people, doesn't it? We've experienced this throughout this whole pandemic. Where socially, you just don't even know how to operate because you don't know in which moment you are going to be an outsider. I remember talking with a coworker. Currently, I work at St. Luke's in the IT department, and we were filming something, and I was talking to this gal who had COVID. And so I asked her, I said, you know, you're feeling better and everything, but how was it when you had COVID? She said, I was embarrassed. I was embarrassed that I had COVID because I had done all the protocols, all that I thought to do. And then when I had COVID, I just thought everybody felt I let them down. I felt socially I was removed. Have you felt that? Maybe you've had COVID, maybe you haven't, but when you've been in a store, even with a mask on and you cough, how do you feel? socially, there's that removal. So we've seen it during this, and I'm sure socially during your life, maybe you've had those moments where you feel removed just because of the situation. We have the physical, we have the social, but there is a spiritual component to feeling apart, isn't there? I mean, Pastor Brett has just finished the foundations of the fall, whereby because of sin, there was separation from God. There was a separation from His life because now we were doomed to die. There is a problem because we are all sinners from the womb that we are doomed to die. There is issue with sin. This morning, I think each one of us can identify sin in our life. It may be something that's way back in the past. It may be something that's been repeating every day. It may be something that's more recent. For almost 2 years now, I haven't been pastoring. The Lord has used that tremendously in our family, brought us to Idaho, put us in a great position. And the Lord has used that time to help peel back some of my heart and to help me examine as He sees me and say, you know what? There's some sin there. There are some things that you have ignored. There are some things that you've continued to allow to exist in your life, Jason, that is not allowing you to draw as close as you could. There is a separation, pal. This morning, do you know your leprosy? Maybe the physical ones, they're nothing. The belt, nothing. Maybe the social ones, overblown or whatever's going on. Maybe some of those are legitimate. But what about this spiritual one? What about that sin that you know? That sin that the person who doesn't know you, who's sitting beside you, that stranger, they don't know. Maybe it's also the one that your spouse or your good loved one next to you, they don't even know. But you feel it. The separation between maybe you and God and maybe you and those other people. Do you have that in you? Do you sense that leprosy? Do you sense suddenly the need for us to be along with those who are outside saying, I don't want to be declaring unclean, unclean. I suddenly find myself being a person who can't do anything for myself, and I need a master. I need an eternal one who saves, and right now I want to call out to Him. Do you sense it? And that's what's going on with the lepers. Here is one who has the command, the authority to do something about it, and they, by faith, are calling out to Him, Jesus, Master. Have mercy on us. It says in verse 14, when He saw them, He said to them, go, show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. Now this is amazing right here. This is amazing because what we read about in chapter 13 was that they were supposed to go back to the priest and be inspected. After 7 days, be inspected. After another 7 days, be inspected until it's recognized that you are cleansed. So Jesus says, go ahead and go do that. Go fulfill the law. Go show the priest. But it says, as they were going, they were cleansed. They weren't cleansed and then went. Jesus commanded them, go show yourself to the priest. As they went, they were cleansed. The word cleansing, that removing, that washing clean. Clean, not unclean. It's pretty awesome. When they had gotten to the priest, a new set of rituals would have been carried out according to Leviticus. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back to Leviticus and see what happens in Leviticus chapter 14. This is what would happen in order to help declare cleanliness for the lepers. Leviticus chapter 14, we're going to start in verse 3. All right, so the person has been inspected. They need to be brought before the priest. So it says in Leviticus chapter 14, verse 3, "And the priest shall go out of the camp, and the priest shall look. Then, if the case of leprous disease is healed in the leprous person, the priest shall command them to take for him who is to be cleansed two live clean birds and cedar wood and scarlet yarn and hyssop. And the priest shall command them to kill one of the birds in an earthenware vessel over fresh water. He shall take the live bird with the cedar wood and the scarlet yarn and the hyssop and dip them and the live bird in the blood of the bird that was killed over the fresh water. And he shall sprinkle it seven times on him who is to be cleansed of the leprous disease. Then he shall pronounce him clean and shall let the living bird go into the open field." Anybody been a part of a service like that? I haven't been to First Baptist one time and ever seen Pastor Brett sacrifice a bird up here. Is that coming? It's not happening in January anyway. This is totally foreign to us, what's happening here. They go inside and there's this ritual that begins with this cedar wood, scarlet yarn, hyssop branch, two live birds. Later on, there's even more that's really special. It says that they're supposed to take some of this blood and then they put it on the right earlobe, the right thumb, and the right big toe of the leper. Now they're being touched. Now they actually receive a treatment with that blood on the earlobe, blood right thumb, blood right big toe that only is ever given to one other type of person. Do you know who that is? The priest. Pretty amazing. Additionally, after that, they were supposed to also bring in just about a pint of oil, a little less than a pint. And as they bring in that oil, what they would do next is take the oil and put some of that on the right earlobe, right thumb, right big toe. Totally foreign. I've never seen Pastor Brett do this either. He could probably do it on Nate now that he's got a bare foot toe over here. That's your left foot, though. So, after that, the priest would take the oil and dump it on his head and anoint him with oil. Do you know who else is anointed with oil? Priest. So the leper is taking one who was unclean and outside, and by the ceremony is being called into community, called back to the inside, and declared clean. A far different picture from the one who was disheveled. Far different picture from one who had sin on their hands. Now, in Jesus' day, people looked at lepers and said, yeah, there's something on their skin. Yeah, socially, I don't want to get it. But they also thought that the leper had that leprosy because they were sinful. They were stricken. There's a few stories in the Old Testament where people received leprosy as a judgment against them. Miriam was one. King Uzziah was one. Elisha's servant was one. And so everybody, every Jew thought, well, if you have leprosy, you've obviously sinned. There's something wrong. So get out. How special it was then for the leper to be told, go to the priest and show him. And on the way to be clean, knowing that there would be this ritual of saying, you are declared clean and here's some marks to show it. Here's the blood on your lobe, right thumb, right big toe. Here's the oil on your lobe, right thumb, right big toe. You are clean. You've been atoned for. A removal of that which was dirty and leprous. So Jesus, back in Luke chapter 17, has now sent them and they are cleansed on the way. Verse 15 says, "Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks." Now he was a Samaritan. One guy doesn't even make it to the ceremony. He's like, "I am so overwhelmed with what Jesus has done for me, I will turn around and go thank him. I will throw myself at his feet to show the status that he is everything and I am nothing. And I just want to thank him. I want to pour out my life to him. Praise God." And he does it loudly. He throws himself at Jesus' feet, which is astonishing because he wasn't a Jew, he was a Samaritan. There was still something about him which everybody else would say, "Get him away! He's a half-breed. He's racially different than us. He's spiritually not as good as us." And yet he comes and throws himself at Jesus' feet saying, "I don't want to be any other place but near the Master, near the Savior. I recognize what God has done for me, and it's more than me just going now and doing a ceremony. I want to be with him. I don't want to be apart from him. I no longer want to be the one who is unclean and separated. I want to be the one who's clean and with him, as God has come to be with us." So beautiful. So beautiful. That one who could still say, "I'm not worthy," would say, "Oh, but I want to be with him." And so he goes back to Jesus and he throws himself at Jesus' feet. And Jesus says in verse 17, "Then Jesus answered, 'Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?' And he said to him, 'Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well.'" The leper returns and Jesus is astonished. "Where are the other ones to give thanks? I thought there was 10 of you." One returns, gives thanks. And then Jesus says this amazing thing to this man. "Go your way. Go back to living life. Because here is what has happened today. Your faith, you believe that I am the faithful one. Your faith has made you well." If you look there in the footnote, "made you well" also means you've been saved. The word here in the Greek is sozo, which in the New Testament is the word for salvation. Earlier for the 10, they were cleansed. They were healed. Their bodies were made pure. They could go to the temple and they could have the ritual. But something occurred in the heart of this Samaritan man where it was more than just a cleansing on the outside, more than just a social ability to gather once again, but he was saved. Something occurred in him where he said, "This is my Savior. This man has done something in me that I cannot do for myself." He was feeling salvation. "Your faith has made you well. Your faith saved you." We go back and examine what was happening in the book of Leviticus. That was all Jesus. If you go back and look at what the priest was to bring to that ceremony, it was all Jesus. He brought a wood plank, cedar wood. He brought a scarlet thread indicating blood. He brought a hyssop branch, which, if you remember, that was the paintbrush for the lamb's blood over the door at the Passover. It was the same thing that David cried out in Psalm 51. "Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean." It was an instrument of cleansing. And then finally, there were the 2 live birds. And did you recognize what happened to one of them? It suffered. One of the live birds was killed. Its blood was drained out into water and sacrificed. It then says that the plank, the yarn, the scarlet yarn, the hyssop, and the live bird were all dunked in that bloody water. Now here's the key thing. It says that at that moment, the live bird was set free. That is all a picture of Jesus. The one who came into this village and had the 10 lepers cry out to him, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." It says he was in that place, headed to Jerusalem, because he had set his face on Jerusalem. If he had simply cleansed the lepers, removed their skin ailment from them, and then went on to just live a life and retire and die an old man. Woe to those lepers who are now physically clean, right? Woe to us if we think by changing our belt, woe to us if we think just by curing things socially, we can help and save ourselves. No, we need help into our hearts. Something's got to change in here by which Jesus saves us. A lot of us try to fix our problems. But at the end of the day, there's going to be a lot of well-dressed people who end up in hell. There's going to be a lot of people who have dealt with an addiction and they've become sober. And they will be in hell. There are a lot of people who have sang the Christmas carols better than anybody else has ever sung them. And they will be in hell. But that would have been the case for all of us had Jesus not set his gaze on Jerusalem. Had he not left these lepers after he healed them and gone on to Jerusalem, because the scripture says that Jesus went to Jerusalem and by his wounds we are healed. Isaiah chapter 50 verse 6 says that he gave his back to those who would strike and that he gave his cheeks to the ones who would rip out his beard. And as a lamb, he was led to the slaughter. And he went on to Jerusalem. And he went up Calvary. And he was nailed to that tree. And the scriptures say that in that moment, he became our sin. He who knew no sin became our sin. For our sake. The scriptures say that his blood cleanses us. That we're like that live bird who's dipped in the blood and then set free. But in that moment on Calvary, Jesus was being tortured because he took our leprosy. Because that thing that you thought of earlier that was your leprosy, he took that. He forgives that. If you let him, if you call upon him. And it says in those moments on the cross, that place that he would go and fulfill his mission, that while he was on the cross, he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? The one who was in with the Father in fellowship was now out of fellowship because of our leprosy. And he died outside the city for my leprosy. For your leprosy. And so it is for lepers to call upon Jesus and say, Jesus, Master, have mercy upon me. Some of you are going through some mighty difficult things, aren't you? Some that I don't know, maybe some that the pastors don't know, maybe some that those sitting next to you that you love, they don't even know. The wrestle that's going on inside, you just feel like you need help. Some of you don't know Jesus. You've never said, I want your mercy. But you're going through something difficult. And God might be using that. You ever look at these stories of the leper and say, I wish I was a leper and could be healed like that. Wish I could experience the mighty work of God in me like that. Even though none of us would really want the leprosy, right? Our church in North Carolina, there was a man who ended up getting a severe liver failure. They loaded him up with medication. The guy could hardly talk because he was literally being poisoned by too much medication. And he came to church. He was an ornery fella. He could be a real stinker. And he knew it. But his family, his granddaughter had invited him to come. And so he began coming to every service. He began coming to the midweek Bible studies. And he just began to look at Jesus. And he began to realize this wasn't just a case of his liver failing. This was a case of his heart not being well. This was a case of him not knowing Jesus. And every week he would say, please pray for my health. And he would at times kind of get better, and then at times it would get worse. But there was a day when Greg finally said, Jesus, have mercy on me. Do you know what he attributed that moment to? He said he never would have come to that moment of looking upon one whom he needed had he not needed him because of his physical ailment. He said, the only reason I ever put my eyes upon Jesus was because I got sick. God used this really hard time in my life to bring me to faith, to give me sozo, salvation. And the beautiful was, once Greg was healed, he changed. He'd still joke with you and rib you once in a while, but he wasn't a stinker. He wasn't ornery like he was. He changed. God had healed him on the inside. And so it was almost astonishing that shortly after that, Greg died. His liver failed. His family wondered why. But do you know what Greg said before he died? If in my death my son will come to faith, then let me die for Jesus that way. Greg's life had become one who, in a lot of ways, Greg felt like he was outside. He needed friends and he needed God. And God used that tremendously hard situation, that leprosy in him of both physical, social, I guess that's three, spiritual leprosy. God used that to draw him to himself. And now his way of falling at Jesus' feet, praising God, was to saying, here's my life, take it. And if you can use this to get my son, please do it. Christmas sermons are some of the hardest to preach. Funeral sermons are some of the easiest. Because lepers sit in the pews, raw, staring at death, saying, there is something to this separation. There is something to death. There is something that is not right with me and God. So it was at Greg's funeral service that I had the great honor of preaching about Jesus. And to have his son weep after that service, not only for the loss of his father, but he said, I am so far from God. I need Jesus. Morning, you may have that thing in you that just feels like you are distanced. Particularly, I want to address if you have sin that's going on in your life and it is causing you to be distant. Jesus loves you so much. His desire is that you would not be distant. But the Lord desires to have mercy on you. He loves you. This last year, as the Lord peeled back my heart and showed my leprosy, that was hard. I've never struggled with faith before. I've never struggled to stand before a congregation and say, Jesus loves you. Here's His grace. Call upon Him and He will save you. I struggled with believing that He loved me. I struggled with believing that He wanted to show me mercy. I struggled with accepting that when He said, I forgive you, He meant all of it. I struggled that when He said, I have forgiven you and removed your sin, that it didn't mean I needed to come and sit in the back of First Baptist and be anonymous. Jesus' desire is fellowship with you. His desire is fellowship with brothers and sisters in community. His desire is for you to say, Jesus, have mercy upon me, and to repent. And so this morning, in response to the Word of God, I would suggest three things. First, call upon His name. Call upon His name. Jesus, Master, have mercy on me. Second, repent. Turn from your sin. Turn from your leprosy. Let Him save you completely. See yourself as the bird who is dipped in the blood and released. See yourself as the leper who has been dabbed with blood on the earlobe, the right thumb and the right big toe. You've been anointed. The Holy Spirit is given to you. And move away from your sin and draw close to Jesus. That's what He wants. And then finally, like the Samaritan, and this is often the driving point and principle of this passage, is that in seeing how marvelous Jesus the Master is, in recognizing that I am cleansed, turning from sin and turning to Him, that we get to go back to Him and say, thank You for all that You've done. We get the opportunity in this community of this church to declare who Jesus is and to thank Him with all that we have. And this morning, it's not enough to say that Jesus is the reason just for Christmas season. He is the reason for this morning. He's the reason for your next breath. He's the reason for tomorrow. He's the reason for when COVID ends. He's the reason for the rest of your life, even in your death and for eternal life. Jesus is everything. Let's thank Him this morning. This morning, make it a commitment that your life will be spent at the feet of Jesus, thanking Him. And then when Jesus says, go your way, get back into your life, go back to school, go eat dinner after church, go back to the doctor, wherever He has you to go, live a life of thanks. Recognizing what He's done for you. How good is Jesus? If you're struggling this morning to figure out what plays to run in your life, I won't tell you this morning that this is a football. I'm just going to say this is Jesus. Call upon His name, repent of your sin, and let's thank Him this morning together. Father, we come before You and we give You thanks just for this record that You've given us in the Scriptures, this holy book that declares who You are and what You've done. We're grateful that we as a people, though we find ourselves leprous, and you have revealed that to us, have also given a way for our leprosy to be removed. This morning, Lord, we come and we confess that we're a people that desire in our flesh idolatry. We desire sin, and we ask that you would change that. We ask that you would cleanse us and set us free, save us. We pray that you'd make us a people of praise, a people living out our repentance as we draw close to you and go on our way, whatever that is that you call us to do, in constant thanksgiving for what you've done. Thank you for setting the lepers free. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I think when we acknowledge the fact that we have received that mercy from our Master, the Eternal One who saves, and like the one leper, we turn and come back. I think our fitting response is just like what he did, to fall at the Master's feet and to offer everything to him. And when we do that, it blesses his soul. The words of this song, I think, are so fitting to finish what we just heard. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. Worship his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great. Your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul. Worship his holy. Like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship his holy name. holy name. Worship your holy name. Sing like never before. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name. These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the laborers in the desert, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Good job, everybody. So did you want to have everyone take a seat and stick around for that video? Yep. Okay, let's all have a seat and we'll watch that video together. And then we're dismissed.